Okay, is this working now? Yes. Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you so much for coming today. It's been a great experience working on our exhibition about Sicily. It's something that was relatively new to me as a scholar, of somebody who worked mostly in the Eastern Mediterranean, so I was really thrilled to be asked to help out with this exhibition in the British Museum, along with my colleague Dirk Booms, who's only recently come back from Malaysia, so I think he says he's still jet-lagged, I don't quite believe him. But anyway, he is also busy with various other events. It is wonderful having a co-curator there because then we could share all the events, although very few of them are ever chores, they're always a pleasure because it's great to talk about the exhibitions that we work so much on. I will concentrate perhaps more on the ancient side of it today because the exhibition, those of you have seen and those of you that hopefully will go and see it, is divided up into two major periods when Sicily was, we think, at its peak politically, culturally, economically, and in terms of the innovations in technology. It was also two periods when it was being envied by the known world at the time. When we concentrate particularly on the ancient period, specifically with the Greeks, and then later with the Norman period. The Greek period, of course, goes down from, say, the 8th century BC down to around the 3rd century BC. The Norman period, much shorter, in the 11th and 12th centuries AD. The connection, though, with the society is very strong in that we have a wonderful object that was mentioned by the President earlier on, the Beckett casket, which has been in the British Museum for quite some time now, but we were lucky and fortunate, and thank you very much for allowing us to move it into our special exhibition, where we've put it with other objects, other reliquaries, and also objects of the same kind of technique, and help to tell the story of the connection between the Norman Kingdom in England and the Norman Kingdom of Sicily. We find that so many of our visitors to the museum know certain things about history. 1066 is an important date in the English calendar. I know it all too well. Living in Hastings, we see it everywhere. You know, I love the fact that every evening I approach battle stations on the way home. I always feel I should put out a lightsaber or something. But it's a wonderful period of history that people know something about, but they never really connect it with Sicily. I think even people that go there, we've asked people that go to Sicily, they go on lightning tours, bus tours, they go to the ancient Greek-style temples, very rarely go into the archaeological museums. They go to the Norman palaces and churches and cathedrals at Monreale, Cefalù and in Palermo. But again, they rarely go to the museums holding medieval material that come from some of the treasuries and palaces. So they see the monumental side of things, but not the associated portable objects. So portable objects like this are extremely important to helping to show that relationship between Sicily and the Norman Kingdom in England. So thank you very much for lending us that. We also have many other wonderful loans from the Society in the museum that you might be forgiven for having not seen for a while. They're all objects that are extremely important to us because they're examples of things we haven't got in our own collections. Particularly for the Greek objects, we have some wonderful gold jewellery, silver vessels, one or two marble portraits that we don't have examples of at all. So we're extremely fortunate and thank you so much for lending them to us. And hopefully we'll find a way in the future of making them more prominent in our galleries. But I want to talk tonight about ancient Sicily. Please forgive me, hopefully Dirk will come along at some point and talk to you all and have the opportunity to talk about later Sicily in one of his talks. The talk today is Tyrants and Temples, about the ancient Greek rulers on Sicily and the kind of monumental art and the way that they kind of basically showed off on a world stage. Sicily, as you know, is kind of right slap bang in the centre of the Mediterranean Sea. And ever since the earliest men got into ships and boats in the Mediterranean, they've encountered Sicily. They've dropped off on its shores. They've met its rugged coastline. They've navigated its wonderful triangular shape, occasionally going through the Straits of Messina by Italy for a bit more protection. Legends and stories are told about these areas. Again, legends that you might know but not necessarily think are associated with Sicily. But I'll tell you more about that later. The other islands around it are extremely important. All these Mediterranean islands from Cyprus through to Crete, Rhodes and Crete, Sicily, Sardinia, Malta, all these islands have played a major role in shaping Sicily's history over time, not least all the other settlements around the mainland of the Mediterranean. But why did people go to Sicily? And the main reason is Mount Etna. Those of you that have been there, I'm sure many of you have, and hopefully some more of you will go after the exhibition, is that it's dominated on the east side by Mount Etna. It's one of the most spectacular volcanoes that I've seen. And it's always doing something. Fortunately, it gave us some wonderful publicity at the beginning of the exhibition when it erupted just after, fortunately, the objects had arrived from Sicily with the couriers. But they reported from back home that Sicily was erupting, Etna was erupting, which of course gives us great publicity for the exhibition, but also is the main reason why so many people went there over time. It was one of the most fertile regions of the Mediterranean. It allows for great agriculture, growing of grain, raising of livestock, and the ancient Sicilians were famous for raising livestock, sheep, goats, horses, pigs, other animals. They raced horses on the island. They grew all kinds of different crops, and then later on in the Arab period, they've probably transformed the island more into the island we see today with the citrus fruits, rice, and other more exotic plants from North Africa and the East. But the fertility of the land is one of the most important reasons why people went there. There's this old view, of course, that many of us still fall into the trap of saying that the Greeks went around civilizing everybody. This isn't true, I don't think. Archaeologists are finding the remains of wonderfully rich and diverse cultures, sophisticated cultures on the island, way before the Greeks or even the Phoenicians arrived. And there are often these cultures named after the site where they're most prominent or most prolific, named after by various archaeologists, the most famous of which was Paolo Orsi, who gives his name also to the museum in Syracuse. And I mentioned earlier on that people tend not to go to museums in Sicily on the whole when they're doing general tours, but the museums there, particularly Syracuse, Agrigento, they are arranged in such a wonderful way. You really get that feeling of chronology and time and different cultures on the island, and they're very, very proud of all these different regions. They also are so proud that even when we suggest to them that, yes, you've lent us these wonderful objects for Sicily, would you like an exhibition about Vikings or mummies or something? They all say, actually, we'd like some of your Sicilian objects. It's like, come on, you know, you've got many of these already. But on the other hand, they're so proud of these. And this wonderful gold bowl, which is another item that Sir William Hamilton gave to our museum in 1772, comes from the site of St. Angelo Muxaro in the south of the island near Agrigento, ancient Acragas. And this was acquired via the bishop of Gagenti at the time, Agrigento, who gave it, apparently according to a French volume, to an Englishman, and at the time said that it shouldn't really have been given to anybody. And alongside it were an almost identical bowl with bulls and two other plain gold cups. And all those other three have disappeared. We don't know where they are. We're hoping that by advertising them through the exhibitions and talks that somebody might find them in their sock drawer somewhere, not knowing what they are, or maybe one of them uses a candlestick, who knows. But we're really hoping that in time these will turn up. But the importance of them is that they show a wonderful relationship between many of the different islands and people that shaped early Sicily. They have a kind of Phoenician shape, although very few of the Phoenician ones were gold. They're also connected with Cyprus, Crete, Rhodes. And the people of Crete and Rhodes were some of the first settlers on Sicily, and they created the settlement of Gela in the southeast of the island. And the people of Gela then sent a sub-colony, so to speak, of people to Agrigento, further southwest along the coast. And it's near Agrigento where these bowls were found, in this community of earlier peoples and St. Angelo Muxaro, in Tholos-type tombs, similar but not related to the ones in Bronze Age Crete and Mycenae. Later on, two gold rings were found during more scientific excavations, or at least the one with the wolf was found still on the finger of the skeleton of which it was attached when it was buried. And all of these show the similar style. They show these wonderful lean cattle with their ribs strongly pronounced, parading around the side of the bowl. The cow there suckling her young, the wolf over there. And it was almost by accident that we've actually got a huge amount of objects in our exhibition that relate to the natural world in both the Greek or the early period and the Norman period. And this was by accident, or can it be? It's just that there are so much great connection between the Sicilians and their landscape. The raising of animals and the natural world was so important to them. Some of the earliest and some of the most striking of all ancient coins come from Sicily, and many of them show symbols from the natural world as signifying particular settlements. Because remember, the Greek settlements from the 8th century BC onwards were not the policy of a unified policy of the Greeks. They were different towns, different city-states, sending out colonists around the Mediterranean, around the Black Sea, to discover new lands, for the aristocracy to find new places to rule, and also to find new trade routes and trade links. So it wasn't a unified policy, but these people, the Greeks, shared a common language, religion, culture, but politically they were always, more or less always, fragmented. And that was the same on Sicily until very late on. So these bowls show that wonderful mixture of cultures, but they were found in the grave of a local earlier ruler who is not Greek, not Phoenician. Were they a diplomatic gift? Who made them, Greeks, Phoenicians? We just don't know. But it's good to have them all together so people can make connections and have, and they're a great talking point. Another weird object that we didn't manage to get into the exhibition because it wouldn't get into the lift comes from near Ragusa, a wonderful town in southeast Sicily. And this is another example of this mix of local and Greek styles in the way that people are represented. What we see in 8th, 7th century BC Sicily is the start of hierarchies in societies. And many of these seem to be based on the agricultural world. Bulls are extremely important in the iconography, so are horses. As soon as somebody could afford a horse and put themselves on top of it, they raised themselves up physically above everybody else. And horses and the aristocracy and the rise of the aristocracy are an important element of early Greek and other societies. And bulls are extremely important. Anybody with a bull in the community would be, you know, an extremely good person to know. Also, the number one sacrifice in the ancient world was a bull. If you could afford to offer a bull to a god, you must have more than one. So it's a great sign that people are starting to divide themselves up into levels. This peculiar object, though, that comes from a lintel of a tomb, has this weird-looking, three-dimensional, rather lumpy-looking head on the top. On one side, it has a bull, which is perfectly understandable for these early communities, and a sphinx on the other side. But this man's head seems to be related to a horse in relief with a big shield, and you can actually see, just about see, if you've got very good eyesight, his legs dangling down by the side of the horse. The shield covers most of the body of the horse, which is probably a good job because anatomically it's all rather strange. But it just looks like it was made and then changed and adapted and modelled over time. But it's a great example of how these early people on Sicily were taking in different ideas. They were using Greek and Phoenician ideas to push themselves up in their society. And there's a rather strange Greek inscription on the side, which is wonderful. It talks about who made it, who it was dedicated to, but we know nothing more about this person. But we know they were connected in some way with the early Greek settlers on the island. These rather strange looking alien creatures here are actually much more delightful in the flesh than they are in any image. They are real representations of how the cult of Demeter and Persephone was preeminent on the island. Any island that relied on agricultural produce, that relied on raising of livestock and using the land, was going to rely on Demeter and Persephone's gift, which was that gift of creating this harvest, creating this fertility on the land. And they offered back in huge numbers in many different sanctuaries all over the island. You go to any museum in Sicily, there are huge amounts of dedications to these two goddesses. There are many lamps found amongst the dedications to show that some of these rituals or mysteries took place in semi-darkness. And they're often in places that aren't canonical style Greek temples, not the kind of pediments and columns. There are a series of different rooms within a sanctuary where the mainly female worshippers would go and perform different rites in different places. But these wonderful cult statues also show a tradition in Sicily of mixing materials. And Sicily has no natural marble sources. So the Greeks, frustrated at this, very quickly thought, okay, we'll use limestone as the predominant sculptural material, also terracotta. They have rich clay sources, and they made some of the bodies out of limestone. The exquisite drapery carved into this figure on the left here is just magnificently done, and it compares to the best of the marble sculptures from the later 5th centuries BC. But they've added a marble face, the flesh parts of the female figure are added in imported marble, and you can see one arm and one foot doesn't survive, but the rest of it is there. The hair may have been real hair, it may have been a wig of some sort, it may have been gilded wood, it may have been limestone or even black marble. The Greeks, when we think about Greek sculpture, we often talk about marble, we talk about bronze, occasionally clay, but if you just read Pausanias, you see all the different materials that were used in sculptures in sanctuaries all over the Greek world. And the two on the right are slightly earlier in date. They come from the 6th century BC and have been dressed by a current fashion designer in Sicily and give an idea about how some of these sculptures actually looked when they were dressed in real clothes. You may not like them, but it does evoke that that strength of how different materials work so well together. And the hands are beautifully but very simply modelled and must have been holding some items associated with the cult of Demeter and Persephone. And one object we have in the exhibition which really burst into life when we lit it in the gallery was this wonderful terracotta painted, I call it an altar, that comes from Jaila, again in the southeast of the island, found with two other similar altars of a type that we find nowhere else. They were found in a building that seems to be part of an emporium or trading post, and they may have been intended to be exported somewhere, but shortly after they were put into the building, it seems to have collapsed around them, protecting them from ever being used. And they have holes in the side where you can put wooden posts to lift them, and I kind of call them my glorified trestle table legs, because they... I should have taken a picture of the other side, but when you look at them in the exhibition, they're kind of slightly triangular in shape. There's a little shelf at the back, and I imagine one of these at either end, planks of wood put across, onto which you put your offerings, your piglets maybe, the number one sacrifice to Demeter and Persephone, and other fruits and vegetables and different offerings to the goddesses. But they're wonderfully portable, fortunately, they were never actually used, so they've been preserved. The goddess in the middle also has this wonderful kind of corn-like tresses of hair that she's parting for you to see. She may be Demeter and Persephone, but it's very difficult in this period where you have this mixture of Greek, Phoenician and other styles, knowing exactly who the goddess is supposed to be. But the idea of fertility is also shown by the panther at the top, who's clearly got milk and she's feeding her young through devouring a bull. And this scene of animal attacks or one beast devouring another is a very common scene in Greek art on the island. The political system on the island, as you know, was mostly the Greek so-called Sicilian tyrants. And this isn't alien to Sicily. Unique to Sicily is a form of government found all over the Mediterranean in the 6th century BC. The word tyrant, of course, has different connotations today, although the Sicilian tyrants were notorious in later literature, and I stress later literature, as being amongst the cruelest and most barbaric of all rulers in the ancient world. This is one of their terrible, apparently, one of their terrible devices in which you could execute people. It's a brazen bull, like a huge oven in the form of a bull, into which you put your victim, light a fire underneath. And even crueler is the fact that the engineer had put into the muzzle of the bull a system of pipes that would transmute the screams into a kind of soft bellowing sound. It's absolutely terrible. But you'll be pleased to know that the first, well, maybe not pleased to know, but the first person put inside was the inventor himself, Periloas, the bronze caster. Whether it was actually ever made, who knows? But these sort of mostly Roman traditions writing about earlier Greek tyrants who they didn't particularly admire, and they even turn up to Sicilian tyrants in Dante's Inferno as some of the cruelest people in history. Some of the stories may or may not be true, who knows? I'm not going to read out everything here, but the expression better the devil you know kind of relates back to Dionysius the First, the tyrant of Syracuse in the later 5th century BC, who apparently was particularly terrible to the people of Segesta when he was asking for taxes and money to pay for his military campaigns. And it's that wonderful idea that better the devil you know. This old lady tells him, I don't want you dead. Your predecessor was awful. You are really, really bad. But whoever comes after you is going to be even worse. So I'd rather you stayed alive. Again, who knows if these are true, but they're lovely stories. And they're the kind of stories that really kind of revolve around an exhibition. And we find actually when we're doing exhibitions about particular places or particular people, it's often very difficult to present an historical event. And some of the most important historical events in Sicilian ancient history, like the Battle of Himera against the Carthaginians in 480 BC, the Athenian expedition between 415 and 413 BC, and some of the later battles, we cannot show very easily with objects. The Greeks love showing battle scenes, but they don't seem to show specific ones, as you know. They don't say underneath each frieze which battle this is representing. They're often very generic and often mythological or legendary rather than real. So it's very difficult to illustrate these in exhibitions, so we do that through other events, talks, lectures, publications, whatever it might be. There's another horrible story here, just in case you hadn't had enough of them yet. Agathocles was one of the few Sicilian tyrants who tried to make kind of gains, territorial gains outside of Sicily. Most of the Sicilian tyrants in their different cities tried to kind of just keep Sicily from other people. Agathocles had managed to do that, so he started to try and attack various places in North Africa. But again, the poor people of Segesta were attacked by Agathocles, who, according to some myths and legends, because they wouldn't pay any taxes and pay money towards his campaigns, he catapulted the entire city into a ravine one by one over a period of 3 days. Is that true or not? Who knows? Probably not. It'd be a very difficult thing to do. Other people say only catapulted a few people. That's pretty bad. Some people apparently had to run for their lives with their heels cut off. All horrific stories, but it just shows how so many people over time tried to kind of bring down the stories of these successful Sicilian kings by saying that they're bringing up all their bad points all the time. Yes, they're horrific, but they don't mention many of the great things they did, many of the great courts that they built up over time, and the achievements that they made. But the Sicilian tyrants did show off on a world stage in antiquity, and they made many dedications at the Pan-Hellenic sanctuaries of Olympia and Delphi, really showing off to people on that world stage. And they were famous for chariot racing and other equestrian events, particularly in the first few decades of the 5th century BC. The events that they won, chariot races, were considered the most spectacular and dangerous of all events. The tyrants themselves probably didn't drive the chariots. They got charioteers to do that. But they showed chariots on so many of their coins, in so many of their dedicatory statues, including the wonderful statue of the Moccia charioteer, found in that small Phoenician island just off the west coast of Sicily, which we borrowed for the Olympic year 4 years ago. And the Delphi charioteer, which is still in Delphi, is now in Delphi Museum, that some think is associated with the inscribed base of Polyxalos of Jela, the tyrant of Jela, again from the 470s BC. It's not always clear whether these monuments actually are related to a specific event, but they do seem to show how important it was to show off on a world stage for these Sicilian tyrants. One wonderful relief we have in the exhibition is this small marble relief, a dedication within Sicily, showing a successful, victorious charioteer who's driving, doing a kind of victory lap around the course, just driving past the turning post represented by a column here, and the reins of his horses would have been added in paint. And there's the famous Delphi charioteer again, just to show he's not an individual statue. There are fragments of horses and also a smaller arm of a groom who is shown in the same group. But they showed many of these successful events on coins, chariot events, some of them where the horses are being crowned by victory, which is a lovely touch, I think, rather than the victor being crowned. The horses get all the recognition they deserve. Mule cart races next to it, which sounds like a strange event. And then fully blown, kind of fast-moving chariot scenes with hovering eagles above. So all different throughout different periods from the 6th down to the 4th century BC, the Greeks tyrants were showing their victories on coins. They also did that, and they commissioned famous poets like Pindar to come to the island and praise both their city and themselves for military and sporting victories. And Pindar, of course, was one of the most famous of these, and writes about one of the battles that Hieron the First, where he beat the Etruscans at the Battle of Cumae in 474 BC, and dedicated a helmet in honour of this. Others are commemorate victories in battles and also in chariot racing. But the helmet on the left is one in the British Museum's collections that is in the exhibition with a dedication of from Hieron to Zeus in honour of this battle. And there's an almost identical inscription. This is an Etruscan-style helmet on the left, an italic one, and then on the right, a Corinthian one, and that helmet is still in Olympia Museum today. They also built some of the most enormous of all Greek-style Doric temples. The biggest ever Doric building was at Agrigento, ancient Acragas, in southern Sicily, dedicated to Zeus, and apparently dedicated with some of the funds appropriated from the losing Carthaginians after the Battle of Himera in 480 BC. Other great temples stood at Selinunte, at Acragas, and also this wonderful one at Segesta again that the Sicilian Ministry of Tourism keep telling us to show you, or to show it in every single talk that we do, to encourage people to go to Sicily in springtime with all these wonderful spring flowers around it. The temple at Segesta seems to have been built almost as a folly, though, for the Athenians to be impressed by, because it was built in the later 5th century BC when the people of Segesta were keen to get Athenian help in trying to crush the might of Syracuse that was rapidly becoming the most important Greek city on the island. And the people of Segesta asked Athens to come over, invade, conquer Syracuse, and try to kind of push them down. They were getting too big for their boots. So they built this magnificent temple. They didn't quite build it. They didn't finish it. They didn't flute the columns. They left all the lifting bosses on the stone. They may not have ever roofed it. They may not have dedicated it to a particular deity. But it was there to impress the Athenian embassy when they came over. The Athenians, of course, did come over and famously lost the fleet and many of their soldiers at the famous Sicilian invasion or adventure that took place between 415 and 413 BC. Another event, very difficult to show through objects, but very important in the history of Sicily. Some of the Sicilian temples built, again, in honour of some of the battles, particularly the Battle of Himera, with these funds from Carthage, include the wonderful Temple of Athena that's now encased in the Duomo, the cathedral in Ortigia on the and Syracuse. And you can see just at the top the Doric frieze still there from the building, the columns at the side, and they filled in the gaps with stone. But inside they cut through the walls of the temple to make these arches. You can still see the columns inside. It's a wonderful way of preserving these ancient buildings. The best preserved Greek temples usually were the ones that were turned into churches and cathedrals. And there's the Temple of Himera, a more typical Greek temple, more or less only the base remaining. But this wonderful series of lion head spouts decorated the exterior of the temple and still preserve much of their ancient colour. Because remember, these are mostly limestone, so the colour soaks into them more and is often much better preserved than on marble sculptures. But some of these sort of harsh lines from these kind of angular temples that you see so much of in the ruinous, because they're very romantic ruins in the landscape, but they were softened in antiquity by wonderful terracotta plaques and revetments that were both functional and decorative. And the Greeks needed to drain water off their buildings. We always forget about the roofs on Greek temples. They are kind of like something we don't even think about. We just see kind of birds flying through them. We imagine them all being open air. But they had roofs. They had tiled roofs. They find many tiles in excavations of Greek sites. But they very rarely ever reconstruct roofs on buildings. But these terracotta revetments that the Sicilian Greeks became famous for making over time were amongst the best in the Mediterranean. And they softened these angles by putting these wonderful kind of teardrop-shaped devices with palmettes. All the circular water spouts have different designs. And then you have these wonderful patterns that kind of create circular and fluid designs over these very sharp angles. For some reason, the Greeks never invented downpipes because all the drainage comes through these water spouts at the side. But they also made temples to be buried in almost. You know, those people who wanted to aspire to be amongst the ranks of the gods would do that. And one object that I would have kind of swum over to Sicily to collect and swum back on my own if I was allowed to borrow it, but unfortunately it was too fragile, is this wonderful terracotta sarcophagus. Please go and see it in the museum in Ravenusa, in the province of Agrigento on the island, that basically usually has zero visitors a year. It's a wonderful museum, and this is one of my favourite ever ancient objects. It is a temple in the form, sarcophagus, in the form of a Doric temple. It has beautifully preserved colour on it, and it has kind of graffiti engravings of helmets and goblets and all kinds of material that may or may not have been buried within the sarcophagus itself. But also this wonderful tombstone cap, which we do have in the exhibition, this one made of limestone, which would be on a high pillar inscribed with the name of the deceased. But it's a wonderful way of showing the upper part of a Greek building that we often, like I said, lose. The Doric frieze is shown beautifully, all the elements around them, a column in the pediment, but I should have shown another picture, but beside that, have a look in the exhibition. It shows the tiles in great detail, and it helps us to put some of the objects in the exhibition that come from architecture into a kind of a contextual space. This terracotta model here of an early Greek temple shows a horseman on the top, a very popular motif on early Greek buildings on the island. And also these kind of gorgons and satyrs with their face puffed out, and their cheeks puffed out, as if they're blowing the bad spirits away from the sanctity of the sanctuary that they're protecting. Horsemen were a really common device on early Sicilian buildings. Here's a wonderful, relatively complete one in terms of the Greek world. That's relatively complete. But this wonderful horse's head that we have in the exhibition comes from one of these equestrian groups that kind of emerge from the roofs of the buildings. Even more dominant on the island are gorgons. Sometimes they're Medusa, sometimes they're male, but often they are there as a decorative device. Sometimes just a face, other times the full figure, in this wonderful kind of running pose. Some of them, the one at the top, are over a metre high. Others, like this little gold plaque, are only the size of a postage stamp. But gorgons were predominant on the island. They seem to be everywhere. You find them a lot in the Eastern Mediterranean as well, but on early Sicilian buildings, they're there all the time. And many of the architectural devices on early Sicilian buildings are kind of almost perhaps there to kind of assert Greek identity on the island. It's a difficult thing to talk about. Some people say it's not, you know, it's not a propaganda exercise. It's just they're showing tales from Greek legend. But some of them are there, I think, and I believe, to kind of just show that the Greeks are there. They've arrived. Looking over the Phoenician cities, kind of building these colossal temples and saying, we're Greeks, you know, don't mess around with us too much. But one of the wonderful objects we have in the exhibition has been affectionately, though perhaps kind of to her detriment, now called Thomas the Tank Engine, because she has this wonderful kind of face that's kind of emerging almost from a tunnel. And it's a little bit, you know, it's one of the gorgons that's perhaps less frightening than the others. But of course, anything when you have added colour, it always adds kind of an extra dimension of perhaps terror, although perhaps more comedy with this one. But anyway, it's a functional piece. It's a tile ridge cover, and you can see this kind of domed element that goes over the ridge tiles at the top of the building, and also the lateral tiles would have been accommodated through these gaps at the side. And her face would have stuck out over the pediment roof, trying to again scare off evil spirits. They have more traditional forms of Greek sculpture on early Sicilian temples, though very rare. Pedimental figures are extremely rare. But metopes, particularly from the site of Selinunte in the southwest of the island, was rich with an early series of metopes. And some of these may, in fact, have ended up in the British Museum. I'm quite glad they didn't, but it would have caused us even more trouble. But two English architects in the early 19th century went to Sicily, Angel and Harris, and they started digging at Selinunte, and they were moving huge tons of stone. That's a site where some of the largest ancient Sicilian buildings were. And they found a series of wonderful archaic Greek metopes of a type that we don't have in the British Museum. We're very rich in other periods of Greek art, but not of these early archaic architectural sculptures. They're richly decorated. The colour is well preserved. Again, it's soaked into the limestone. But many of them show excerpts from Greek myths and Greek legends. It's not like a narrative that runs throughout the building. It's almost like they are trying to kind of drum into the Greeks who look at the building. This is a legend about Medusa. This is one about Perseus, Theseus, Aphrodite, whoever it might be. They're there on the buildings, just almost staring out at you as if they're having their photographs taken. This is a rather brutal scene showing Perseus decapitating Medusa. Pegasus, her son, has already kind of appeared at the side, which is a bit out of sequence. Athena standing beside him, just kind of supporting Perseus. And this wonderful drawing by Harris from the original drawings that are in the British Museum, hopefully some of which we're going to lend to the museum in Palermo in the next year, show just the state that they were in when they were found, but they're extremely animated. They're not a kind of sculpture that had been seen before in the early 19th century. Most of the sculptures have been relatively heavily restored Roman marble sculptures. This was a kind of sculpture that was unique. The Sicilian authorities very quickly kind of commandeered the sculptures and set up some of the earliest laws of antiquity in the Mediterranean. And now you can see these in the museum in Palermo, or you could if they ever opened up the galleries again. They've been sort of closed down for several years now. But we've borrowed a few of the pieces from Sicily, from Selinunte, including this wonderful chariot scene of two deities. We don't know quite who they are. Gently patting the heads of these rearing horses who are restless. They want to get the chariot moving. They want to be in one of these races. It's some kind of mythological event. Is it Persephone being brought from the underworld by Hermes or Hades or Demeter? Who it is, we don't know. But it's a wonderful scene. And again, this frontal style of sculpture, which is typical of the 6th century BC on the island. Here's a whole series of them, Heracles and the Cecropes. There's Medusa again, a wonderful chariot scene there. And the later ones from the later sort of early 5th century BC ones, show a very kind of moving scene, always between a male and a female figure. We have Heracles and the Queen of the Amazons, maybe Zeus and Hera, perhaps Hades and Persephone. You have Actaeon being devoured by his own hounds. This is the most lively of all the scenes, by Artemis, and then Athena, and then Enceladus, the giant, who she battled with in the battle between the Olympians and the Titans. These are stuck into the walls of Palermo. We'll never be able to get these agreed. You know, they'll never agree to move these. But we did borrow some of the smaller portable objects. The wonderful thing about these limestone sculptures is that they use like a local limestone for the main panel. The male figures are all carved out of limestone, so are the dogs and other animals, seats. But the female faces and flesh parts, like those big statues of Demeter and Persephone earlier on, were made of marble, imported marble. It was almost as if they were using marble as a precious stone in a cheaper material. And it's that wonderful effect. You can imagine them completely coloured with bronze attachments, metal attachments, but the female face is perhaps kept slightly paler, almost the colour of the marble, maybe just with some kind of protective layer, but glowing and really predominating in these scenes. The other form of architectural sculpture, very dominant and prominent on the island, these huge figures that are affectionately known as telamons, though some of them are actually male, not always female. The giant ones from the Temple of Zeus at Akragas, this one reconstructed in the museum, are up to 8 meters high. You can see a drawing here by Cockrell when he first went to the site, how he's kind of used a bit of artistic license here, making them far more beautiful than they do today, but just showing them just kind of effortlessly holding up the building. Some people think they might represent the Carthaginian prisoners. Some ancient sources even tell us that, who were taken after the Battle of Himera. And some people think, again, this may be a temple built using the funds taken from the Carthaginians. We have, though, in the exhibition, fortunately, one that comes in three sections, so she came in three separate crates and could fit in our lift. And she's a limestone one from the theatre building at Monte Yatto near Palermo, up in the northwest of the island. This was a non-Greek settlement at the beginning, but over time they absorbed Greek elements and built this Greek-style theatre with this wonderful, relaxed-looking Maenad who has a little cushion behind her head on top of which she supports a building. She was joined, as you'll be pleased to know, by another companion and two woolly satyrs to help kind of take the strain. But she is a wonderful kind of example of this typical kind of figure that was so preeminent on the island. They made them out of terracotta and they made them out of other materials as well. This is how they may have been on the building. These are some of the remains of the Temple of Zeus. The fluting between each of these, the flutes on these column capitals here, you can actually stand comfortably between. I can stand between them. They're so enormous. But much of the site was actually looted and used to build the harbour down to the south of the site. And this is one of the best preserved of all the faces, extremely charming representation of either a prisoner, we don't know who it is, an Atlas-style figure, but made, as you can see, in several sections. Telamons are also used on one of the greatest inventions and the greatest kind of engineering feats from the whole of the ancient period, I believe. And this is the so-called Syracusia, this enormous boat that was sent off on a mission around the Mediterranean and designed apparently by Archimedes under the patronage of Hieron II, the tyrant of Syracuse in the 3rd century BC, who was really the tyrant who brought together the Greeks on Sicily. Not necessarily in a friendly way, but he did manage to actually unite them. He also managed to keep the Romans at bay, because this is the period when the Romans and the Carthaginians were fighting over the supremacy of the Mediterranean. Sicily was a focal point, a key point, strategic point. There were Phoenicians on the island, Greeks and other peoples there. Everybody wanted a slice of the island, so they were battling. Many of the battles took place around the island. But this boat, the Syracusia, was really sent out to take Sicilian produce around the Mediterranean, to show it off to the rest of the Mediterranean people. But the only port, apparently, it could dock in was at Alexandria. And the boat itself had telamons around the side. It had salted fish, tons of salted fish. It had horses, it had livestock, it had grain. Lots of people who were going on a cruise around the Mediterranean as well. They were all on this ship that was apparently could float because of Archimedes' various principles, which I'm not going to go into because they're far too scientific for me. But you know, he was the man who was thought to have invented this giant claw that could lift ships out of the water, or create a lens that could burn the sails of ships. And he was born on the island at Syracuse, and he died at the hand of a Roman soldier who was meant to take him alive, because of course he'd have been extremely useful to the invading Roman army. But this really marks the end of the Greeks on the island. The Hieron managed to carve himself out this little kingdom. He created a kind of sense of independence from the Romans, because he sided with them rather than the Carthaginians. His successors unfortunately sided with Carthage, and so Rome decided enough's enough, and they took the whole of the island in 211 BC. The connection, though, with the Ptolemaic dynasty is extremely strong in the way that they were represented. The first coin showing rulers, real people on the island, was the coin of Hieron and the coin of Philistus, his wife, who was also the first female ruler to appear on any coin in Sicily, and the first that we ever really hear about in any prominence in terms of her political power. But she bases very much, we think, her image on coins on that of Berenike II, who she may have met if she'd gone on the Syracusia to Alexandria in the 3rd century BC. And this links very nicely, I'm going to plug another one of our exhibitions now, with Sunken Cities, which is on show also at the museum, with an exhibition about the Ptolemaic rule in Egypt at the time, and how these different rulers represented themselves in different guises. They may have been Greeks or of Greek descent, but they represented themselves in different guises to appeal to different sections of the population. And it's there I want to end today. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope that Dirk can also carry on the story one day. There are various different events in the museum, many different lectures and talks that cover the whole of Sicilian history, not just the ancient or medieval period. Many of the stories that we can't tell through objects or through presentations like this, or we're not the right people to tell them. So we've invited many different specialists along. I hope you've enjoyed this afternoon. Thank you very much for coming.